Try. Try.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. gun violence happens. It happens during your 15th birthday party. Me and my cousins were supposed to have fun. We danced all night. That dancing suddenly came to an end. Riots I heard outside, chaos and fighting. How could you be so cruel? My 15th birthday. Being beaten by men's, gun held to my head. That was terrifying. It was terrifying. It was terrifying. Dark and light spots filled the air, gasping to breathe. Unstable. One voice utterly stopped the chaos. One voice.
What's next?
To understand this violence and indifference to life that we see from the gang-infested neighborhoods, you need to understand that to the gangster, ruthlessness is collateral. A young man with a reputation for racking up a lot of kills is intimidating, and in that world, that translates to power and respect. No one formally joins a gang. The young men I met with just started hanging around gangs, mostly for protection going to school. They got their first guns as preteens, usually a gift. Gunfire linked to gangs is part of every day on the South and West Sides. Just this week, 3 children were killed by stray bullets.
A friend of mine who is like my little brother and I had lost touch. We started talking again. He had gotten involved in a gang and was having trouble keeping his life together. He was going to help his friends find happiness, then he was going to disappear, never seen or heard from again. He was planning his suicide.
What's next?
A startling new report from the Centers for Disease Control. Researchers say teenage suicide is growing at an alarming rate. Since the year 2000, the suicide rate for teens is up 28%, with a startling average of 5 deaths a day.
New CDC data shows suicide rates for boys like Farrell, age 15 to 19, increased more than 30%. 3 years ago, Conrad Rory died in this truck from carbon monoxide poisoning after his friend, Michelle Carter, encouraged him to commit suicide through dozens of text messages. Experts cite family instability and substance abuse among some factors for suicide.
My uncle went to jail on Christmas Eve. He was mentally unstable, on suicide watch. He hung himself on Christmas night. He was hanging for 3 hours before they found him. He was still alive, but brain dead. We let him go.
What's next?
And then, of course, when that verdict was read that he was found not guilty for the murders of Daniel De Abreu and Saphiro Furtado in Boston South End in July 2012, we saw the emotion come across his face, and he was wiping away tears. And I spoke with a spokesperson of the correctional center on the phone this morning, and he told me that Aaron Hernandez was not on suicide watch. There was no indication that he wanted to harm himself. Otherwise, he would have been moved out of the general population unit into another type of cell.
My friend was not sober when he took his own life. That doesn't seem fair. He put a gun to his head in front of the eyes of his girlfriend and best friend. Then his life was over.
What's next?
In the midst of the debate on gun violence, gun rights, and gun control, the largest group of victims is being overlooked. 64% of gun victims aren't at schools or on rampages. Instead, a study in 2012 found most gun violence victims are the same ones who pull the trigger. Almost 2/3 of all gun deaths in the United States are from suicides. It would seem the reason white men are 8 times more likely to commit suicide with a gun is because they're depressed, have no way to deal with it, have a gun in their home, and have decided to use it after only a few minutes. Study after study shows reducing access to guns saves lives and reduces suicide rates, and this might be one of the reasons why.
Making a choice about drinking alcohol with my friends. Worrying about men taking advantage of me. I was in high school, put through multiple situations I should not have been put in. College men didn't care about my consent, and they took advantage of me and my vulnerable drunk state.
What's next?
When I was 12, a boy the same age as me threatened the life of my girlfriend. He threatened to violate me, like he was listing his groceries. "Let me touch you or I'll cut her throat," he said, all while my friend was pretending to sleep next to us.
What's next?
I was spending the night at my then boyfriend's. We woke up and had sex. He wanted to go again. I said no. He climbed on top of me. I fell limp and stared at the wall. I no longer felt like my body was mine. I no longer owned it.
What's next?
We learned today that a staggering 55 universities are facing a federal investigation because of the way they respond to their students in a crisis of sexual assault.
Today, the warning shot from the U.S. Department of Education fired at those 55 colleges and universities that receive federal funds being investigated for possibly mishandling sexual violence and harassment complaints from students. Among those on the list, Harvard, Michigan, Ohio State, Southern Methodist, and UC Berkeley.